Good evening. Welcome to the gathering service tonight. So glad that you're here to be a part of worship with us tonight. A few announcements before we begin. One, stay for Sunday supper. Happens tonight. And then journey groups, if you're a part of those. Stay and enjoy some of the wonderful things going on throughout the evening. Next Sunday is our fall festival, so a little different. No Sunday supper and no journey groups, but come because we have a big, huge event, trunk or treat and a chili cook-off. Lots going on. If you have a special chili recipe that you know is a surefire win, then why don't you bring it? They're going to have a little cook-off and give a reward to the winner that they can donate to outreach. So we're looking for pots of chili for that, and also people to decorate their trunks of their cars, which is how we then have the kids dress up and trunk or treat and things like that. It's lots of fun, pumpkin decorating, all kinds of things. Come and be a part of it. It's a great time as well. If you do come to the Sunday suppers, you know, I hope that you will think about possibly volunteering to help with them. We always are looking for people to kind of jump in the kitchen and help Martha out. If that's something you'd be interested in, let us know as well. Also, the youth starting this week are selling their wreaths. Now, people are like, holy cow, you know, Advent wreaths already, Christmas wreaths, whatever. But yes, by the time they do sell them and then bring them in and all that stuff, the timing actually works out because people like to have them around that first of Advent. So if you see the youth tonight and other nights and next week at the Fall Festival selling wreaths, if you'd be interested in doing that, it's a great way to support the youth, help them get some money for some of the mission trips coming up in the spring and those things. Other things are obviously on the calendar as well. One thing I will mention was the Dodson lecture. We've heard a lot about that. The reception itself, the tickets we were selling, sold out. But if you can still come, the reception, the actual lecture is free and open to the public. If you come at 6, though, the doors open at 6, and it's kind of first come, first serve seating. So if you're interested in coming, you can still absolutely do that, but you might want to think about getting here a little early in case we run out of room. Also, another opportunity for Pursuing the Beloved Community, a conversation about race that St. John's is co-sponsoring. Read about that. It's an interesting opportunity to be a part of that conversation if you're interested as well. Let's take a minute, prepare our hearts and minds, and we'll begin and worship God together.
Please rise and sing with us.
Welcome to this holy place, friend and stranger, saint and sinner, all who gather here. Come, all who hunger, all who thirst for life in all its fullness. Come with hope or hesitation. Come with joy or yearning. Come. Generous God and generous Savior, touch us through your Spirit. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Stay with us, Lord. Since the day is far spent and the night is coming, kindle our hearts on the way, that we may recognize you in the Scriptures, in the breaking of the bread, and in each other. Amen. Be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things, plans formed of old, faithful and sure. For you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin. The palace of aliens is a city no more. It will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will glorify you. Cities of ruthless nations will fear you. For you have been a refuge to the poor, a refuge to the needy in their distress, a shelter from the rainstorm and a shade from the heat. When the blast of the ruthless was like a winter rainstorm, the noise of aliens like heat in a dry place, you subdued the heat with the shade of clouds. The song of the ruthless was stilled. On this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on this day, Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise and join us in singing our gospel hymn.
This is the Holy Gospel of our Lord Savior, Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. When the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. O Lord, take our minds and think through them. Take our lips and speak through them. Take our hands and work through them. Take our hearts and set them on fire. Amen. If you have ever been involved in making up a guest list for a wedding, you know that it can sometimes be a tricky business. Say you want a fairly small wedding. Whom do you not invite? Well, you have to invite Mr. and Mrs. Toff. He's the president of the company. And if you invite him, what about the vice president? And well, you couldn't leave out Aunt Jane. She's done so much for you. But you're not really fond of her husband. And so it goes. Now, if we sometimes have difficulty deciding who's in and who's out, just imagine how hard it would be to make up the guest list for a royal wedding. Several years ago, when Prince William and Kate Middleton married, the British royal family had to do just that. I imagine they had an A list, a B list, a C list of those people who were to be invited. Of course, most people in the country were not going to receive an invitation, just a favored few. The A-list would be a small elite group who got the best seats. The B-list folks would have to content themselves with fairly poor sight lines. And the C-list, well, those people were in another room watching a live feed. Even so, I would think that people scrambled and finagled to get a place even on the C list. So who would turn down an invitation to a royal wedding? Can you imagine it? And yet, in the parable we hear today, evidently, lots of people. A king is giving a wedding feast for his son. Invitations to the wedding are sent out days in advance. And then on the day of the wedding, the king sends his servants to remind his guests that everything is ready. However, the guests tell the first group of servants, "No, they can't come." The king sends more servants. And again, the people refuse the invitation, ultimately killing the messengers. The king, of course, is angry. He takes his army and destroys the town, and then sends his servants out to invite everyone they can find to the wedding banquet. All the while, the oxtail soup and the veal roast are getting very cold and dry on the wedding table. By now, of course, we know that this story is unrealistic, fantastic. The details just don't make sense. I mean, who kills the mail carrier? And how much time does it take to destroy an entire town? And anyway, isn't this the king's town in which the banquet is taking place, where the food is steaming hot and ready to be eaten on the table? But what really seems unfair to us is the man who is invited off the street but gets thrown out because he isn't dressed properly. What is going on in this story? Well, as you know, of course, it is an allegory, a story that doesn't worry too much about the details but has a point to make. So to understand what Jesus is getting at, we need to reflect on the care and love that God has poured out in preparing for us, his invited guests. Over and over in Scripture, we read of God's banquet. In today's reading from Isaiah, we hear, "The Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. He will swallow up death forever. He will wipe away the tears from all the faces. Lo, this is our God. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." This is the invitation to the wedding feast for the king's son. It is God's invitation to us. God doesn't have an A list, a B list, a C list. We are all invited. God's invitation is an invitation to joy, to glory, to eternity. Who would refuse it? Well, as we said, apparently many. And maybe at one time or another, we all have. Sometimes we find it hard to trust in God, to really take the risks that God is asking of us. Sometimes we're just too busy, and we think, well, I'll think about all this God stuff later when I have more time. And sometimes our shadow self steps up and says, hey, I can do this by myself. I don't need God at all. I wonder if the man without the wedding garment didn't have some of these thoughts. We notice that when the king asks the man, how did you get in here without a wedding robe? The man is speechless. He can't answer. He doesn't even have an excuse. Perhaps he feels that the king sees right through him, understands him, and he just doesn't have anything to say. Scholars over the years have focused on the wedding robe, and so do we. We feel it is the key to the story. What is it? Where does it come from? Evidently, the other guests had on wedding robes. Where did they get theirs? St. Augustine suggests that it was a robe provided for the guests by the king. And in a sense, I think that's right. The wedding robe is simply the gift of grace that God provides, that God offers to us all, and our acceptance of it. It represents the covenant God makes with us. I will be your God, and you will be my people. The other wedding guests have accepted God's gift of grace and are focusing on God as the center of their lives. They are showing the fruits of living as a guest at the banquet of grace. They represent the people whose lives are being transformed by the love and grace of God. But the man without the wedding robe is the person who doesn't really want to keep his part of the covenant. He is the one who thinks, I don't really need God. Oh, maybe once in a while when I'm in trouble, I'll say a prayer, but I can stand before God on my own. Now, St. Paul says we must put on the Lord Jesus Christ, that we must wear Christ like a garment. The one who doesn't wear the wedding garment is standing before God in his own clothes. He is clothed with himself rather than with Christ. And I think at one time or another, we've all been that person. We've all said to God, I can do this on my own. And ultimately, the result of that thinking has been our isolation from our brothers and sisters in Christ, our separation from God, and our tears of loneliness and pain. But when we understand the magnitude of the gift God has offered us, the grace that he gives us, we find we are never alone, that we need have no fears, that love surrounds us. Scholar Marilyn McIntyre says this about grace. Grace comes to us before birth and sees us through. Grace is the context in which creation lives and moves and has its being. We dwell in it. We float on it. We are saved by it again and again. And so we can afford to risk and venture and fail and fall because we fall into the arms of a gracious God who allows us to try and try again. But the invitation is only the beginning. Now we live in Christ and we put on the life of Christ. St. Paul, again, tells us now how to dress for this new life. He says, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. These are our clothes, the clothes of the kingdom, compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, patience. As we wear these clothes, we find ourselves caring not only for ourselves, but also for others. We remember those of our brothers and sisters who do not have a place to live, who are hungry, who have no food, who are imprisoned behind walls of depression and grief, and we offer them help and companionship on the way. And finally, we put on that last and most important piece of clothing, the gift of grace that binds everything together in perfect harmony. We put on love. As God loves us and comes to meet us at this weekly foretaste of the heavenly banquet, we come forward wearing the wedding robe of love. We accept God's gift of grace and offer back to God our love, our thanksgiving, our gratitude, our very selves. Amen.
As night falls and courage sometimes falters, let us turn our hearts to God in prayer. We pray for those gathered here and all that lies heavy on our hearts. We pray that you would know our needs even before we recognize them. Grant us those good things for which we dare not, or in our blindness cannot ask. We pray for those in positions of leadership in the world, our nation, our state, and our city. Grant them the spirit of wisdom, charity, and justice, that they may promote the well-being of all people. We pray for the sick, the bereaved, the oppressed, and the homeless, that they may be comforted by your Holy Spirit, who brings light to the darkest places. We pray for the broken and torn fabric of the earth as it yearns for healing, trusting that you make all things new. We pray for this and all communities of faith. We pray that you would open the hearts of your faithful and seek your truth and pursue it in love. We pray that you would disturb us, Lord, when our dreams have come true because we have dreamed too little, when with the abundance of things we possess, we have lost our thirst for the water of life. Push back, we pray, the horizons of our hopes and move us into your future in strength, courage, hope, and love.
Merciful God, as we come before you this night, we keep in our prayers all those who have been affected by the natural disasters of the past months, especially those this week who have lost homes and loved ones in the fires in California. In the midst of such hurt and chaos, we know, Lord, that there is peace and hope that can come from you. Wrap all those affected by these things in your loving arms. Now, Lord, we take just a minute in the midst of busy lives to lift our prayers to you. The things that are heavy on our hearts and minds are the moments of joy that we want to be thankful to you for. We ask all these things in the name of the one who gives us our clothes to the wedding banquet, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now let us confess our sins. God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that ensnares us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen. Through the cross of Christ, God have mercy on you, pardon you, and set you free. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. God strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us share that peace with one another. Please be seated. Over the last few weeks, Amy, come on up. Over the last few weeks, we've been hearing St. John's Minutes about St. John's and the impact that this place has in so many people's lives and the way it transforms not only what we do here and the people who are a part of this community, but also how it pours out from this place into the community around us. And tonight, welcome Amy Jackson, who third time's the charm is going to share a St. John's Minute with us.
Thank you. Good evening. Are you sitting today in the same place you sit every time you come to church? Growing up, my family always sat on the last pew of our small town church. Here at St. John's, my husband David, our children, and I also find ourselves gravitating toward the back in the same general area. Familiar people sit around us each week, usually at the 10 o'clock service. The Helitz girls and the Espositos, the Becks, the Booths, and May Justice. A few extra 10 or 11-year-old boys often squeeze in with us when the children return after Sunday school. Some are new friends, and some have been at St. John's for years. In fact, now our pew overfloweth in the happiest way. Actually, at the 10 o'clock service, I had to move to a different pew because it was so full. Perhaps I shouldn't admit this in front of the whole church, but while I'd say the Jacksons are regulars, we are not here every Sunday. I know people notice. Our pew neighbors ask us how we've been, and David Olson teases my David he is making notes in his official book. Mostly, though, I'm reminded of an idea Nancy Peek told me about years ago, the chicken noodle soup ministry. If you weren't at church on a given Sunday, you must be ill and need chicken noodle soup. Those people who usually sit near you would notice you were missing and make a timely delivery right after church. That sentiment of paying attention to those around, or not, has stuck with me ever since. Lately, I even send our pewmates a message if we are going to miss so they won't worry. The chicken noodle soup ministry doesn't really exist, but even in its fictional state, it's not about feeling guilty for missing a Sunday. I see it as a symbol of being invested in a caring community, of people noticing a neighbor is absent, of introducing ourselves to new faces around us, of celebrating goodness and reaching out to those who are hurting in our midst and beyond. Ultimately, the church community is about being inspired and changed by the divine example of Jesus living among everyday people and situations. The people of St. John's have shared kindness beyond measure with our family, and I hope we have given back at least a bit through the connections we have made, both formally through programs or committees, and informally through the sharing of peace with a stranger, delivering a meal, or bringing friends to attend worship with us. We will certainly continue to try, since following Jesus' example is an ongoing pursuit. May we all strive to do that today and every day. Thank you.
Thanks, Amy. We've had wonderful stories like the Jacksons family about people that have been changed by this place, and I hope as you think about stewardship over the last few weeks and maybe even going ahead, think about how you could maybe invest in St. John's, what kind of time you could give, how you could share your gifts in this place to help us change not only this church community but others as well. And yes, being willing to make a financial commitment that helps us do ministry here. So as we wrap up the stewardship season, I hope you've really enjoyed hearing about how St. John's transforms lives. If you're a visitor tonight, very special welcome to you. We're happy to have you here gathered with us in our midst. And know that as we move to the time of Holy Communion, you're welcome at this table. Come share a meal with us. We'd love to have you. And if you're here as a visitor and simply, or anyone, and simply love to come and have a blessing instead of take communion, just cross your arms across your chest. Mary, I will bestow God's blessing upon you. Now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering, sacrifice to God.
Our offertory hymn is Holiness. You may sing seated, and I'll invite you to rise before the third verse.
Jesus, be our guest, with friend, with stranger, with young and old, be among us tonight. Come close to us, that we may come close to you. Strengthen us, that we may strengthen one another. Renew us, that where we have failed, we may begin again. In the beginning, God made the world. The world flowed from God, and God shaped it, filling it with light and life. God knew the world, but we chose not to know God. We turned from him, and though he sought us through patriarchs, matriarchs, and prophets, still we stray. Our rebellion imperiled the fullness God intends for us, and when the world could bear no more, God sent Jesus, his Son. Among friends gathered round a table, Jesus took bread, and having blessed it, he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. In the same way, he took the wine, and having given thanks for it, he poured it out and gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant with God, sealed with my blood. Take this and share it." Lord Jesus Christ, present with us now, as we do in this place what you did in an upstairs room, breathe your spirit upon us and upon this bread and wine, that they may be heaven's food and drink for us, renewing, sustaining, and making us whole, and that we may be your body on earth, loving and caring for the world. Through, with, and for the love of Christ, we share this bread and cup in the unity of your spirit, Father Almighty. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith, with thanksgiving.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sisters, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, brothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown? Good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sinners, let's go down, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sinners, let's go down, down in the river to pray.
Let us pray. Eternal light, shine in our hearts. Eternal power, be our strength. Eternal wisdom, guide us as we serve you. Eternal goodness, you have drawn us to your heart and united us in the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. Now grant that with all our heart, mind, and strength, we may evermore seek your face and all those we meet in the world. Amen. Now, as you go from this place, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please rise and join us in singing our closing song.
Go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Thanks be to God.